things that they're worried about, which is financial stability. They're worried about money laundering. They're worried about, you know, bad actors coming in. We have to acknowledge that as a community. We can't just say it doesn't exist. It does exist. It exists in every emerging tech. Bad people come in. But what can be done to make that as minimal as possible?
When you look at Swissborg
est sorti ce matin.
They have an app where you can buy crypto.
They connect to Binance, HitBTC, LMAX, and Kraken and find the
best rates in the market.
What I like about Swissborg is that they have an amazing app
that can directly buy cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin and also cash out as well.
Through Swissborg, all assets will have a fiat gateway. And here is the thing.
Premium features gives you zero fee trading.
That is zero fees.
If you want to buy Bitcoin with fiat, I suggest you buy through Swissborg rather than Coinbase.
If you're interested in trading the likes of Ethereum or Bitcoin, use Swissborg's application.
In a fast-moving and confusing crypto asset market, get an edge with Crypto Slate Edge. Enhanced in-depth news coverage and extensive crypto asset and sector data are all part of your exclusive access as a member, helping you understand the market with features such as on-chain metrics and sentiments, all of which allow you to convert knowledge into action with an ad-free experience. As a bonus, access our private Telegram channel to receive live insights whilst engaging with the CryptoSlate community. Subscribe now at cryptoslate.com/edge.
Dear crypto community and blockchain buddies across the globe, welcome back to Kryptonites, the no BS blockchain channel built with the community and for the community. And today we have another mind-blowing guest, Sandra Rowe, CEO at Global Blockchain Business Council. And we're going to talk about some really cool topics such as seeing everything through the lens of an MPO, an NGO, the UN, some of these organizations, institutional organizations, and more. So without further ado, but before we kick off, a big shout out to Nate at Crypto Slate, who's here today with us. Don't forget to check out the summarized version of this interview if you prefer reading. And without further ado, Sandra, thank you so much for coming on the show. How are you doing today?
Hey, Alex, thank you so much. Greetings from sunny New York City.
I miss New York City. And Sandra, it's been such a pleasure looking at your background and what you've been doing in this space, really pushing forward. And I'd like to kick off, you know, with a simple story of what took your breath away, to quote Top Gun, when it comes to the crypto space, getting involved as much as you are these days.
Yeah, I heard about it in 2011. I kind of really got into it in 2013. I was a banker in London, having just gone through the financial crisis. You know, the whole world seemed to be a meltdown from a financial standpoint. And I took a look at Bitcoin as a technology and thought, hey, if this could work, it could really make major paradigm shifts and changes to more resilient financial systems. That's really where I started. But then as I got more into it, I'll be very frank with you, I actually saw the potential of how do we use blockchain technology and crypto, tokenization, digitization, all the stuff that's going on to actually help solve real world problems. And that also means I've pivoted my time to focusing on crypto related to financial access. How do we bring more people into the system who actually have options? People can decide what they want to do with their money. But the question is, how many people actually have access to things in a way that's fair and equitable?
That makes a lot of sense, and I'm sure resonates with a lot of people out there. Sandra, I must ask you, you know, just earlier we were talking about the kind of movements and the mindset that some people have in crypto these days. And it sounds like some of us are missing one important aspect. And I know that the social impact is really important to you. What are we missing today? And how would you like our mindset to evolve with regards to the crypto community?
Well, we have a saying at the GBBC, and we're a Swiss nonprofit, so we don't have a for-profit interest other than to grow the pie for everybody. We have this view that we want to bring the brightest minds and the best, you know, the kindest hearts together, because together you can make money, be successful, create opportunities, but also solve for real world problems that frankly, and be a voice to folks in society who don't have a voice. And I think the more that the crypto community gains in power, influence, and ability to make decisions, we need to think about that.
So you were mentioning earlier that a lot of people are looking to grow their wealth, but not necessarily giving back to society. Could you help us a little more on that angle and what you think we should focus on doing, you know, from this point onwards and not just, you know, think about becoming rich, for instance?
Well, look, I want to be very careful. I think if people want to make tons of money, that's not a bad thing. Go for it. If that's your thing, wonderful. But I also think with that comes responsibility that there are lots of people out there who don't have the ability to make lots of money and have a nice life. So what can you do to help solve that? Whether you care about climate change or empowering women and girls or whatever the topic is, find something that means something to you and help the people who don't have that voice and the influence and the money to be able to make that change. And I think, you know, I want to be very careful not to be judgmental because people should do whatever they want with their wealth. Absolutely. But I would hope as a community, we're not going to do the same things that the former generations did and think of everything as a zero-sum game. I win, you lose. I get everything, you get nothing. It's a very terrible mentality and culture, which I hope we're not like that.
That makes a lot of sense. And for those watching out there, if you do have your own social impact or SDG goal with regards to wealth, what would you do if you were able to make a lot of money? Would you contribute to society? In what way? Please don't forget to share that and put that in the comment section below. That resonates a lot with me, by the way, Sandra. I think, you know, there is one way where we should think about the greater good. And of course, if we are able to increase our wealth, why not throw it back to society and help in some way, right? To leave a positive, you know, an extra positive, right, to everything that's happening.
Absolutely. And look, I've said the words, and I'm going to show you with example and action, because I believe, like, if you're going to say stuff like that, you better back it up with action. It's not just about me giving money. So there's plenty of opportunities where I give money or give Bitcoin. But I also think about, okay, where could I also invest in people I believe in, that I meet, that are not in my normal circles? How do I extend myself out to, like, secondary, tertiary circles of folks I may not normally meet, but, like, try to reach out to them and figure out if I can help invest or make connections or influence in some ways or speak up. In the very least, doesn't cost us any money to speak up about topics that we really care about. And let's face it, what I love about the crypto community is we're a global collaborative community that lets pretty much everyone in. Let's face it, all of us in some way are probably a little bit weird, and that's okay. That's actually really cool. And we celebrate diversity. And I think we need to carry that in every aspect of, you know, what's going on in the world as we get more influence, because there's a lot of broken stuff in the world that probably needs our help. And if everyone can do their part, it's not necessarily about using your money power, but it's about using just your ability to see and identify an issue and speak up about it.
Makes total sense. And, you know, you have a really good lens on what's happening with the UN, with NPOs and NGOs, et cetera, et cetera. Like, what are some examples that you think are really meaningful these days? You talked about, you know, empowering women a little bit earlier. You gave a few examples, but what are the specific use cases that you think could help real world situations, solve real world situations that are the most meaningful to you, at least?
There are so many examples, but let me give one that I just find fascinating because that wasn't the original problem that this group was trying to solve. So GBBC did a hackathon during UN General Assembly Week a couple years ago, back in 2019, where the World Food Program sponsored one of the challenges. The challenges was to end hunger. And that challenge, then the winner of the challenge was actually Producers Direct, which is a UK-based nonprofit. And that nonprofit is now working with the World Food Program in Peru in one of their cooperatives to digitize that cooperative. And the reason why digitizing the cooperative is an important step forward is helping farmers keep records. Oftentimes this stuff is like on pieces of paper, and then, like, there's a fire or there's, you know, floods and the paper goes away. It's actually really amazing how kind of arcane the systems still are. But this is the power. This is the power of what technology can also do. So with the registrations, men were typically the only registrant per farm. And if you look at most small shareholder farms, it's the entire family that actually works the farm. So why is the wife not getting equitable treatment and recognition for being a farm owner? Well, with a new platform that allows for the recognition of the identity of the woman alongside the man, that goes a long way to empowering the woman to also have fair ownership. Now, we need the legal piece, don't get me wrong, but that pushes pressure and pushes the system to recognize the woman as a rightful owner too.
That's very cool, because that sounds like it actually encompasses multiple scopes, right? It encompasses women, it encompasses like ending hunger, entrepreneurship. What is, like, in terms of like the hot topics from the UN side or other NPOs and NGOs, have you seen any things that are really going to get solved through blockchain? Or it, because, you know, a lot of these organizations, unfortunately, it's a lot of, you know, paper passing, right? A lot of bureaucracy, and there's very little action. Is something actually getting done, or is it just people talking around a table?
No, there's real action happening. And I have to say to you guys, I'm the first to be skeptical of large organizations like the UN with myriad of agencies and folks around the world, you know, really getting stuff done. But I will have to tell you, take a look at the World Food Program Innovation Center run by Bernhard Kowach. He is in Munich. It's an organization based in Munich within the World Food Program. Take a look at that. They've got a lot of opportunities for startups to help engage, and also they develop those ideas that you solve for by real money and real resources behind it. But also check out Oxfam in Vanuatu. Sandra Hart is amazing. She's using programmable money to distribute in crisis situations. And that programmable money is based on a blockchain. And the concept is pretty simple. Instead of like bringing tents and food and things from other places, which by the way, takes up energy and more money and effort to transport, give people money or cards to basically spend on the local economy. In cases where that's possible. Now, there's some extreme cases where that's not possible, but what they're doing is changing the dialogue around giving around disasters. Instead of giving things like food and shelter, they're actually saying, look, we're gonna give you an ability to have e-money or programmable money, and that will allow you to go spend it locally and get the food and whatever that you need.
Yeah, it sounds like they're trying to teach them how to fish rather than giving them the fish, as we say, right? Where they're giving the tools and providing the environment for people to have more long-term or sustainable goals, I guess.
Yeah, check out Oxfam in the Pacific Islands and what Sandra Hart is doing. It's actually really, really cool. It's real stuff. They've already piloted. It's going into like scaling. You know, the problem that we have today is not that these things aren't real. It's about how do we scale it? How does that then transfer to disasters in the Caribbean? How do we use the same system that works, and we know it works because we tried it out in Vanuatu, to other places? And that's the challenge we have today.
Makes a lot of sense. Yeah, thank you so much for sharing that. It's quite rare that we cover this on Kryptonites, where we look at it from, you know, one of these massive organizational perspectives and NPOs and NGOs, which, as you said, it's very important. It's more than charity, right? There's a lot we could do in this space. And if you guys have any ideas and comments and to share, please do in the comments box below. I would love to ask you, Sandra, on a personal level then, what are some of the trends that you're really excited about this year? Obviously, you know, we're going through a bull market. There's lots of tech being developed. What are some specific things that are being built, whether it be ecosystems or tools, that you find absolutely fascinating these days?
Well, I'm keeping a close eye on the next evolution of Ethereum. I think we do need to go to proof of stake, and we do need to get these transaction prices down, or transaction fees down. But beyond that, what I'm really excited about is just seeing hope coming back into the world related to funding startups in different parts of the world. I mean, the US and the UK and certain, you know, developed nations have already picked up pace in terms of startup funding. But what I'm really interested in is looking at where is funding going with respect to places that don't usually get the money. So certain areas in sub-Saharan Africa, in South America, in Southeast Asia, we're beginning to see that people are shining light in these areas and saying they need capital. And it's not just capital coming from their own government. It's actually foreign capital, whether it's a group of crypto entrepreneurs who have the, you know, resources to put something together and do that, or whether it's traditional venture capital. The point being is, I think we need to really rethink the way capital flows to early stage startups. We need more innovation hubs.
Yeah, the scaling of Ethereum, obviously going to 2.0 Serenity, I think it's a key point, right? Especially if you want microtransactions or micropayments. Currently with the gas fees, it's very limiting, to say the least. Do you think it's going to happen this year, by the way? Because obviously they announced that 1.5 is They're trying to get that done within, you know, this year, but we know there are always delays and stuff like that. How optimistic are you? And are there any alternative chains that you're looking into that could help with these solutions temporarily?
Yeah, I mean, look, I know we've all been waiting for a long time, and it's a difficult, you know, I'm not one sitting there developing, so I'm certainly not going to make comment on how hard everyone's working to get this done. And there are just so many challenges. But we just had a conversation actually yesterday with Joe Lubin of Consensus. And, you know, I think there's growing optimism, cautious optimism that we'll get there this year. I think we really need it as a community. And, you know, let's face it, a lot of people are building on Ethereum, and it's really critical infrastructure at this point. It's not an option. It's really like we need it.
We definitely need it. We definitely need it. With regards to blockchain regulation, and obviously this is probably something that you've been thinking about a lot, and a lot of people are scared, you know, with all the FATF, you know, and travel rules and stuff like that, impacting possibly, you know, regions that who initially had access to crypto and limiting their abilities to no longer have access to crypto. How are you feeling about this? Is this one of your big concerns this year, or what is if it isn't?
Yeah, we speak to a lot of governments around the world. Don't get me wrong, we don't speak to all of them, but we try to get to as many as we can. And if anyone's interested, if you go to our website, gvccouncil.org/GSMI, we have something called the Global Standards Mapping Initiative. And what we did with a bunch of other groups last year, and you can see everyone who was involved last year, we mapped 185 jurisdictions where if you hover over the interactive map, and it's all free, you could actually find all of the legislation, reports, guidance that came out of any regulator, any government entity we could find for that country. We literally put it all in one place for you related to crypto, digital assets, and blockchain. And so we've been really trying to figure out who is banning crypto, who is taking a more conservative approach to crypto, and then who's actually helping to set guardrails, but also help with innovation and the proliferation of crypto. So there, obviously, there's a whole spectrum of countries. There is a short list of countries who are banning crypto, and we're trying to educate. We never will dictate to a country what they should do. That's, you know, their monetary policy. But we would hope that a blanket ban approach is something that doesn't have to happen. They can take a more, you know, reasonable approach in terms of setting guardrails on who can access crypto in the beginning. And hopefully, as they get more comfortable, then enlarge that. And it takes time for some of these countries and some of these officials. It seems like a threat. And I think what we need to try to do is change the dialogue that this is an opportunity, not a threat. And with the things that they're worried about, which is financial stability, they're worried about money laundering, they're worried about, you know, bad actors coming in. We have to acknowledge that as a community. We can't just say it doesn't exist. It does exist. It exists in every emerging tech. Bad people come in. But what can be done to make that as minimal as possible?
That makes a lot of sense. Finding that fine line is the most difficult part, isn't it? Where can you be? Where is it over-regulated versus under-regulated? And like you say, we have bad actors in crypto as well. So regulation is not all that bad, right?
It's hard to come up with like black and white lines, meaning it's all bad, it's all good. It's so much more nuanced than that. And I know that's a, you know, seems like a cop-out answer, but it's actually true. There's a lot of gray, and we need to figure out in a world where countries are going to want to regulate, what does that regulation look like? And then influencing that regulation to make sure that it's reasonable.
Yeah, my biggest fear, I would say, is probably, you know, if we start having to require, you know, KYC and all these things on DEXs, for example, right? Where someone out of a sanctioned country can no longer participate in DeFi and just kills the entire purpose of DeFi, which is decentralizing finance for all, right? Completely inclusive. So I don't know if that's one of your concerns, but that would be one of the scary parts, especially if you're trying to help, like you said, sub-Saharan countries and countries that tend to be sanctioned or often, you know, just kind of excluded from finance.
In a perfect world, I'm going to put it out there to anyone who can solve this problem, which is why I'm spending so much time on digital identity these days. If we could have a system where you could be identified through a mechanism, I think it should actually be a utility. I don't think it should be a company or a government. But if your identity could be verified at a global level, then that, and then you would receive some sort of, you know, QR code. We can make it simple, QR code or some sort of identifier that allows you to transact without having to give up to every single crypto exchange or every single place you go and trade your identity over and over and over again. But actually, you've already been validated, and therefore you're allowed to. And frankly, at a certain like amount of crypto, none of this should really be an issue. It's really around the larger transactions that should actually be, a problem that needs to be kind of addressed. But having said that, I wish we could find a better solution for how we identify people and institutions and allow for the vast majority who are doing perfectly normal, fine things to not be under scrutiny and then end up on records or lists or whatever it is. I think that's the issue, is like, where do we define protecting people from bad actors and catching the bad actors versus letting people just go on with their life, right? Without being having their privacy invaded.
It's so true what you're saying. You know, having this decentralized identity, probably one of the most valuable NFTs we could produce out there, right? Because identity, I mean, it's hard to argue there's anything more important than identity, right?
I would love a system that would help us to, and you may have to check in every, because let's face it, our identities are dynamic. Like, I might move to another country. I might be in another place. But is there a way for us to keep updating our identity so that we have control over it, but yet we can actually then attest to, and then others have attested to allow us to do things like trading, freely, or to be able to show our health records freely. But it's our choice. And I think we need to start there. And I feel like that conversation is still a ways off, because we're still arguing about just basic frameworks around digital identity and governance. And a lot of it's government issued.
And like you said, Sandra, it is our choice. And that really brings me to the very first concept of, you know, of course, we're in this to build our own wealth, but also thinking about the greater good, contributing to society. And if you guys have any ideas, once again, please share them below. If you think that Sandra has a good point of setting another goal to doing something that contributes to the greater good and not just growing wealth, don't forget to share that with us. Sandra, it's been an absolute pleasure having you. We're going to put links below for the Global Blockchain Business Council, and so that everyone can stay tuned and stay up to date with all the information you're sharing, which is really, really helpful for the community.
Thanks a lot, Alex. It's what we're here for. We exist because we're trying to help educate those who don't get it. And we're trying to also make sure that the crypto community translates the messaging of what we're trying to do in a way that, you know, bridges the gap.
The gap is extremely important. And don't forget to translate the message yourself as well, guys. Join us every Wednesday, premiere at a PC near you, 8 o'clock GMT. See you next week, guys.